Hi, I'm Peter Travers, movie critic for Rolling Stone, and I'm here to tell you what's going on at the movies. And I have cat food with me today, and you might wonder, what is this? You know, cat food? Am I eating it? Is that what happens to critics when they see G.I. Joe and Transformers 2 in the same summer? No. Cat food is integral to a movie called District 9 that you probably know nothing about because there's no stars in it. The star of this movie is its producer, Peter Jackson. And he found a guy, 29 years old, South African filmmaker called Neil Blomkamp, and the two of them got together. They were going to do a big, giant $200 million movie version of Halo, and they couldn't get the money. Can you imagine that kind of world? So Peter Jackson looked at Neil Blomkamp and said, remember that little short you did a couple of years ago called Alive in Joburg about aliens whose rocket ship lands right over Johannesburg, South Africa? He said, why don't we make that into a movie? And why, instead of breaking the budget, why do we decide not to spend any more than $30 million, which, as you know, is chump change in the world of G.I. Joe and Transformers 2? They made District 9 now into a two-hour feature-length movie, and as far as I'm concerned, they saved the best sci-fi of summer to last. This is a movie that's all about imagination. I mean, here we see 28 years ago, while there was still apartheid in South Africa, this spaceship comes, the aliens land, the media is everywhere, and suddenly, given the apartheid in South Africa, the aliens are all put into townships, into districts, which play like concentration camps because the rich whites don't want any of them around. And what happens in this movie 28 years later is they're not going to move them to District 10, which is a way basically to get rid of them. So it's got subtext, it's got theme, but hey, don't be scared about this because the movie is totally whoop-ass. You get petrified, and you get petrified through a central character played by a South African actor named Sharlto Copley. Now, you don't know it. It's even hard to say, maybe. This guy is great. He reminded me of Jeff Goldblum in David Cronenberg's The Fly, because as a bureaucrat, he's sitting there trying to get rid of these aliens, who look like prawns, by the way. They look totally, they've got these little tentacles, and they're called prawns in the most insulting way possible. And there's interspecies prostitution going on. They're living there, they just want to get out, but they can't, and their spaceship is just hovering over Joburg like this. But what happens to this character, Wykus, who is played by Sharlto Copley? He gets something on him. He gets a little bit of this something alien on him and begins to turn slowly into an alien and finds, strangely enough, something human about himself in there. I'm not going to say anymore. I'm just going to say, yeah, you'll be scared. This doesn't insult your intelligence. The cat food is some little kind of humor that they have because South Africa was known for this kind of production of cat food. And the aliens seem to love it. They love a little raw beef. They love a little cat food. But it's when the central character meets up with an alien who's calling himself Christopher Johnson. You know, I love the alien talk. It's like a little grunt and little kind of... Didn't I sound good? That was me saying, this is really a great summer movie. In fact, the only sci-fi big budget, even though this is sort of medium budget, the only sci-fi movie of the summer besides Star Trek that works to me. So you've got to go. Now, is there anything else out there that's good? Well, I want to throw a bone to a couple of movies. The first one is an animated movie called Ponyo, which is from the Japanese master Hayao Miyazaki. This is a movie in which the voices, there's a little tiny goldfish with a human face who turns into a girl, and that's basically the plot. But Miyazaki has influenced all the geniuses at Pixar, and just visually, you have got to see this movie. It's great. Then I want to throw a bone to Ashton Kutcher, who in a movie called Spread, which, yes, you've seen the plot before. It's a guy who's sleeping his way through Hollywood to get to the top he's never really going to get to. We've seen it in Shampoo. We've seen it in American Gigolo. Hey, we've even seen it in Deuce Bigelow. But Ashton Kutcher is giving his best movie performance in this. He, playing a guy who's basically known for 6 inches and a pretty face, finds some kind of depth in this character, which I thought was amazing. So see that movie for Ashton. And then there's a rock and roll movie. It's a documentary called It Might Get Loud, which is just looking at three guitarists, three pretty, pretty good ones, The Edge and Jimmy Page and Jack White. And we just watch the three of them, and then at the end they get together. That's it. But are you kidding me? This is rock and roll heaven. So look at the good things I've said. District 9 is great. All these other things have good things about them. Scumbaggy time! I'd like to throw this cat food at this movie. This is called The Time Traveler's Wife. It stars two people I really like, Eric Bana and Rachel McAdams. But what is this? I mean, this is chick flick hell. Rachel McAdams falls in love with Eric Bana and finds out he's a time traveler. And every time he winds up back to her, he is naked and he has to go find clothes. And I thought, well, maybe it has some sort of sci-fi appeal. You know what happens? They get married, and then she nags him all the time. She just says, you're late for dinner. You're never home for Christmas, blah, blah, blah. Oh, God, I hated this. Toss the cat food out of it and put it directly into the scum bucket with the cat food. I'm Peter Travers.